Think of a creature unique to Aotearoa.
Shrek, the sheep that refused to be sheared.
Kiwi, tuatara, paua. It's unlikely you thought frog. Once we had 7 native species, now we have 4.
There's certainly species we're worried about as a result of climate change. Frogs need damp, moist conditions to breed and to survive.
For years, we've steadily destroyed the habitats of our bouncy friends. The Hamilton's frog was once found all over the country. Now its only home is here, and it's one of the most endangered frogs in the world. For the 300 or so hanging on, climate change could push them over the edge. The ocean, our big blue, responsible for all life on Earth. Here, we are surrounded by it. We swim in it, travel on it, harvest it. So it should matter to us if it's warming up.
Basically, the ocean is climate. Of all the heat, extra heat and energy that's gone into the planet through climate change, 93% of that heat is in the oceans.
You probably know how heat on the planet broadly works. Cold top and bottom, hot middle, lovely comfy layers in between. Well, not so much anymore. This map shows how sea surface temperatures differ from a recent average. In any given year, some parts are cooler and some are hotter. But over the last half century, you can see that our great big blue has been turning red.
Those warm areas, those particularly high temperature areas, are expanding and they're spreading out. So in other words, climate change is causing a tropicalization of the ocean.
Events in our neighborhood have shown the carnage a hotter planet can inflict on biodiversity, on land and at sea.
The world's largest living organism is dying.
If you're an organism that's living out in the open ocean, your temperature has probably stayed probably within a 1 degree window for, you know, hundreds of years or something, and suddenly it's changing quite rapidly. Can they adapt to it? We just don't know.
These are the seas around Aotearoa. The average surface temperature of each part of the sea at the turn of the century is shown here by the dark blue base. And here's how those temperatures could rise. If we don't reduce emissions and slow global warming, by 2050, we'll likely see an increase of 1 degree in all waters surrounding the country. By 2100, our seas will heat by an average of 2.5 degrees. Parts of the Tasman could be over 1 degree warmer than that. And then there are marine heat waves.
A marine heat wave is a period of warmer than normal temperatures in our oceans for an extended period of time. Marine heat waves can affect our climate, and we saw that a few summers ago when we had very, very warm temperatures in our oceans around New Zealand, and we also had our warmest summer on record.
In fact, the previous two summers, the Tasman Sea has endured its most intense heat waves ever.
When it gets too warm for us, we can put on the AC system or can go and sit in a cold pool or something like that. But of course, the organisms in the ocean can't do that. They don't have any controls like that. So if they can't adapt to this change, they basically have to move or they die.
Recently, biologists have observed a grand migration away from tropical regions and towards the poles, from plankton to crustaceans, to fish and even larger.
You know, they're voting with their fins, if you like. They're actually shifting their distribution, trying to keep cool.
And creatures with fins might be the lucky ones.
This is a big problem for coral reefs. Once they get to a certain temperature, they just spit out these algae that live inside them, and that's why they go white and they bleach, and they don't come back from this.
Coral reefs in the South Pacific are vanishing by about 2% per year. At that rate, in 50 years, they could be gone. The ocean is immense, but for the animals who call it home, we're squeezing that home smaller and smaller.
This is basically going to result in a loss of biodiversity, certainly competition within those ecosystems, and maybe even local extinction of species.
And the outlook isn't any better on dry land.
Biodiversity is at a crisis point in New Zealand. You might lose species or have to think about moving species.
The jewel gecko, the longfin eel, the hoiho are all in trouble. In fact, a recent DOC report makes for heavy reading. 79% of all land invertebrates, 80% of shorebirds, 76% of freshwater fish, and 90% of seabirds are threatened with or at risk of extinction.
So if it gets hotter and drier in the north, some species range, like native frogs, it looks like their whole range is shifting to the south. But if you're already at the bottom of the South Island, then there's not much land below you.
And many species here are endemic, meaning they live here and only here. If their homes vanish, so will they. And that isn't their only threat.
Probably the thing that worries me the most is that our invasive predators could actually thrive with climate change.
Aotearoa has been a plentiful kāinga for us and for the critters we brought with us. So good that in 2016 the government outlined plans to rid us of rats, stoats and possums by 2050, calling it the most ambitious predator control project in the world. And climate change only increases that ambition. As temperatures rise, so could pest populations.
Pests that can't usually survive here over the winter, for example, because it's too cold, are likely to be able to survive in a warmer climate.
We could see, and have seen, booming numbers of paper wasps in Nelson, red deer in Southland, possums and the common rat in everywhere.
Things like hedgehogs, it's in their name, they're a hog, they're like a mini pig. They eat everything. So if they were to get into like the alpine zone, that would be very bad for like ground-dwelling invertebrates and lizards that live up there.
As well as eradication, we can strengthen biodiversity by strengthening habitats. In 2018, the government established the 1 Billion Trees campaign, pledging $240 million towards the planting of a billion trees within a decade.
I think it's really important that we look after the forests we've got because they store massive amounts of carbon. We do not want them to die, we do not want them to burn.
Back at sea, keeping that carbon in the ground could make a huge difference. If we manage to control our emissions and end up on a moderate pathway, the sea surface temperature continues to rise until mid-century, but then it levels out. By the end of the century, the average temperature rise is halved. If we halve our emissions, we can halve the temperature rise in the ocean. But the ocean isn't just warming up, it's becoming more acidic.
So acidification is like the evil twin of climate change. Carbon dioxide is getting into the surface ocean and it's changing the chemistry of the water.
Meaning a shift in the chemistry of life. Over the last 200 years, the ocean has become 30% more acidic, while the carbonate in the water, a component many marine creatures need to form shells and exoskeletons, has dwindled.
Things like mussels, pawa, kena, they all have those hard shells. So if the carbonate in the water is dropping, that means that those organisms, they've got to work even harder to build those shells until eventually the carbonate becomes so low that their shells are in a state where they'd rather dissolve than remain solid.
These are baby pāua in a high acidity environment. The translucent bubble around them are their shells. This little one has had trouble. Its chances of survival are slim.
What we project for the future is if we carry on the same kind of emissions pathways, a 200% increase in the acidity of the water. So that's huge.
Our pāua market exports millions of dollars of stock a year. If that dissolved, it could devastate coastal communities reliant on that income.
Thomas Collins has a business of his own at home, making pāua shell jewellery.
The pāua is a taonga, an emblem of Aotearoa. But every creature on Earth has to call Earth home. And for too many, that home is disappearing. Their only hope is that we take action before it's too late.